Mark is another that I know how to come to.
Oh.
Art team.
Hey, how you doing?
Good, sir.
How are you?
Good.
Thank you.
Glad to have you back.
It's good to be back.
It's real good to be back.
I know it was.
I'm tired of hospital.
Hey, doctors.
So you might have some indecision
just sitting around home for what I do.
That's the worst part.
You had to get up out of your garden and you drink some very soon.
Well, I mean, for your first chance, I guess you could take these two things. But if you like, Susan.
Please stand for the pledge and invocation, and Judge Jackson will lead us today in the invocation.
Bow our heads. Lord, we thank you for all the blessings that you bestow upon each one of us here in this room and in this community, in this wonderful community. And we ask that you look over and guide those who are in control and power and help all of us to make good, just, and right decisions for all the citizens of this county. We ask these things all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
At this time, as we start the meeting at 2:02, Commissioner Brian Town, Commissioner Todd Levent is temporarily absent. Item 3, on to the agenda. Are there any changes to the agenda? Commissioners, do you know of anyone? See, Ms. Phil, I think we're going to
delay
item 4.
Yes, we can put that to the next agenda, the next work session. Would that be okay?
Let's put it on April 9th.
April 9th, okay. That'd be good. I make a motion.
Second. This time, Commissioner Tam is present. 2:03. Motion to move item 4 to April 9th work session. We have a motion and a second. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries 4-0. Commissioner Vince, temporarily absent. Mr. Pop, I think there's one that you wanted on there, the resolution. I think it's a mute point right now.
Yes, sir.
Can we delete that?
Certainly can. Thank you for trying to find or finding out and figuring out saying that it already passed its ripeness. So, yes.
The motion to remove from the agenda.
I'd make the motion to remove item 17 from the agenda.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to remove item 17 from the agenda. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? 4-0. Commissioner Levent still out. Doug, our counselor.
Chairman, I don't have him.
I have one to add, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. I have handed out in front of you all, I think you should see a document called the Notification of Consent to Return of Compensation. This involves a appointment to be a deputy coroner involving Stan Rutledge. And I need to walk you through what this is about, what it means, why it's on here, and I would ask that be added as the last item on this work session. That will require a unanimous vote since there's only four of you.
That's item 19 to be added. Do I have a motion?
I make a motion to add this item 19 to the notification of consent.
Have a motion, second. Please vote. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? 4-0. Is that good enough, Counselor?
It is, sir. Thank you.
Mr. Levin still absent. Any other changes at this time? Is there a motion to adopt the agenda as amended?
So moved.
Second.
Have a motion and second to adopt the agenda. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? 4-0. Levin still absent. Item 4. Presentation regarding proposed relocation of Safe House, the community center for Kern County owned site on Veterans Memorial. Judge Jackson is going to present this.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate the board allowing us the opportunity to make this presentation and present this request here today. Before you, with me today are Ashley Anderson, who's the executive director of SAFFT. She's seated directly to my left. And also Stefanie Lopez Howard, who is with the Criminal Justice Coordinating Council, which is the state agency through which federal funds are flowing that we hope to be able to implement and use. And that's part of the request that we have today for requesting a change in location for our facility. I'd like to thank county staff also for working with us in preparation of making this presentation, in particular Mr. Doug Darrow, the county manager, who met with us several times and provided very valuable feedback and guidance in this process, and also David Thornton, public facilities manager, who provided invaluable assistance in evaluating the new site that we are proposing and all facilities related questions with regard to that new site. As this board knows, you have supported SAFFT in its mission, particularly the SAFFT Family Visitation and Community Center in the past, by donating the use of property and a facility, a house that was renovated by SAFFT with a lot of community support and input and resources brought to bear. And the site is currently located on county property next to Citizens Bank on a large tract of land on Veterans Memorial Boulevard. The SAFFT Family Visitation and Community Center is located on the very front right-hand portion of that larger tract of land. And as we know, it's sitting on fairly valuable road front property there on Veterans Memorial Boulevard. And at some point, we will not be able to probably continue to use that site because it will be used for other things, the business development purposes that the rest of the property is basically slated for. And as I said, it is valuable sitting right on the road there. So in anticipation that at some point we're probably gonna have to move the SAFFT Family Visitation and Community Center, and because we really are out of space in that current location, as nice as it is, and as much as it has provided for the community, the juvenile court, and the families and children that we serve, we really do need more space. And if we're going to implement the new federal grant, Safe Havens grant that I mentioned, the current facility just does not meet the needs or requirements of that grant. But to give you an idea of the impact that SAFFT Family Visitation and Community Center has had on the community in the past couple of years, I believe we went into existence and started serving the community and the juvenile court in approximately June of 2010. In 2011, SAFF served 55 families through our supervised visitation program. And of course, you understand what that is when children are removed by the juvenile court from their homes because they have been either abused or neglected by their guardians. Then our goal is to restore that family once it is safe for those children to be restored in the home, to work on the problems that caused their removal, to hopefully repair those problems, and to ultimately restore those families together in a much stronger state than when the children were removed. And the goals of the juvenile court, as mandated by the legislature, set forth that that is the mission of the juvenile court, to restore families, to protect children, and keep them safe in the interim. And SAFT does provide and play a vital role in all of those legally mandated requirements of the juvenile court. And in order to keep families connected, you have to provide some sort of visitation. When a child is removed from their home, is placed in foster care or in other placements, you need to still keep that family connected and bonded through meaningful contact between the family members. And the supervised visitation program at SAFF does that in a very family-like, very nice environment for the children and the parents. And in 2011, we were able to serve 55 families in the SAFF supervised visitation program. In 2012, we served 75 families through the supervised visitation program. And during the course of serving those 75 families, we conducted approximately 1,300 supervised visitations and parenting classes in 2012. That's another key element of the services that SAFF provides. Again, when children are removed from their homes, usually poor parenting is one of the major issues that cause that removal and one of the main things that we need to address to fix the issues in the home. So allowing a safe, appropriate place where those visitations can occur between family and children also allows the monitor to observe some of the deficits in the interactions and the parenting skills of the parent and to coach that parent firsthand as the visit is going on, before the visit, after the visit, take information learned at the last visit, coach the parent before the next visit occurs, and then following the visit in kind of a debriefing, as well as to engage and target areas in general where that parent needs to work on their skills through other parenting classes. So it's a holistic environment where a lot of things can be accomplished. So if we've taken the traumatic step of removing a child or children from their home, disrupting that family completely, when we do reunify that family, it can be done so they're a better situation for the children, parents, and hopefully so you never, the person having to make the decision about removing the family, namely me, never has to make that decision with regard to that family again. There's one large room at the current facility with a two-way mirror that allows you to monitor visits that are ongoing without being too intrusive. There are two smaller rooms without that same two-way mirror, very small rooms where you can also conduct visits, not as nice as the large room, obviously. But another key component is we want parents to show that to show their responsibility and their desire to reunify with their kids by making all their visits. And obviously evening times and weekend times are at a premium in order for parents to both work, because that's another requirement we place upon parents. You must maintain and hold down a job, show that you're able to support yourself and your children when they're returned to you. But we also say visit your children. So if they visit their children during normal working hours, there's an automatic conflict. So one thing that SAFT can provide is times when that conflict doesn't exist, in the evening and on weekends. But obviously those times are a premium when you only have one or two or three rooms at most. So basically, I'm making referrals to SAFT now. People are saying, I need this weekend time or I need this evening time. They're all full. We don't have enough space in our current location. So that that does limit our options and limit the ability of the court to move on with his business of reunifying these families and gathering the information necessary to do that. Or making the decision that these families can't be reunified and moving in a different direction as well. All that information can be gathered at SAFFT. The other component here, as I said, is we have received the Safe Havens grant from the Office of Violence Against Women. And again, the grant requirements, site requirements, are not possible to meet at our current location. Tell you a little bit about the Safe Haven Supervised Visitation and Safe Exchange Grant Program. It provides an opportunity for communities to support the supervised visitation and safe exchange of children in situations involving domestic violence, dating violence, child abuse, sexual assault, or stalking. Studies have shown that the risk of violence is often greater for victims of domestic violence and their children after separation from an abusive situation. Even after separation, abusers, batterers often use visitation and exchange of children as an opportunity to inflict additional emotional, physical, and or other psychological abuse on victims and their children. This program, if implemented, provides supervised visitation and safe exchange of children by and between parents in situations involving domestic violence, dating violence, child abuse, sexual assault, or stalking. It protects children from the trauma of witnessing domestic or dating violence or experiencing abduction, injury, or death during parent and child visitation exchanges. And domestic violence committed between parents in front of children is defined by the legislature as child abuse. And that makes out the crime of cruelty to children. So this falls right in the wheelhouse of what we deal with in protecting children from child abuse, because we need to protect them from being witnesses and victims of domestic violence by either witnessing it between their parents or other adults who are responsible for them. Of course, we have a lot of juvenile court cases as well as a lot of superior court cases, as you know, that involve these kind of issues. This program would allow us to expand out of the juvenile realm into the superior court realm as well. And we can work from a prevention standpoint, so those children that are in superior court cases with domestic violence involved, whether it be divorce or other straight domestic violence cases, criminal cases, we can hopefully, through this program, prevent those children from being referred to the Department of Family and Children's Services or to the juvenile court because of that abuse or neglect by preventing it from happening altogether through this program. This project through this grant also protects parents and caretakers who are victims of domestic and dating violence from experiencing further violence, abuse, and threats during child visitation exchanges. And it protects children from the trauma of experiencing assault, physical, sexual, or other forms of assault or abuse during parent and child visitation and visitation exchanges. The site requirements that I'm talking about include there being two separate entrances into the facility where these safe exchanges or supervised visitations are going to occur. One entrance for the offender and one entrance for the victim. So you're again reducing the chances that they'll meet or have a chance to engage and any further domestic violence towards one another in the presence of the children or between themselves. It requires two entrances into the facility. Obviously, our current facility does not have two entrances. It has one entrance only. Two entrances into the facility. Our current facility has one very, very narrow driveway with very little parking. So we don't have two entrances at our current facility. We need two parking lots in order to, one for the offender, one for the victim again. So again, we reduce the possibilities they come into contact with one another. Our current facility has, as I said, one very, very small parking lot where that is not possible. And it requires separation of the parties during the times that they are on the premises together, all together. Our current facility makes that very difficult. So we have located another site. It's been checked out by
our own public facilities department, and Mr. Thornton, as I indicated, given us a lot of advice and feedback. This property is much larger. It is over 9,000 square feet. It's located on Castleberry Road, right across from the Cumming Police Department, on the same side of the road where the fairgrounds are located, kind of in front of Tyson's, the old brick courts building, I think, was there. But it's amazing how well this building is set up for our purposes. The two entrances on both sides, with two entrances, many different entrances really, but enough to meet all of our requirements, and has many other attributes that would allow us to have more visits, many more rooms available for visits for the juvenile program, all the separation required for the Safe Havens program. So there's a lot to recommend this building, and we've been able to negotiate a lease price for over 9,000 square feet of only $1,500 per month. A 2-year guaranteed lease. And there is some reimbursement available from this federal grant to help offset the rent costs. We don't know exactly how much, but I have estimated it probably would be on the outside of the maximum, probably around $500 a month, but very likely it could be less than that. But there is some grant funding reimbursement available through the Safe Havens program. Of course, we have no reimbursement available for the juvenile part of the program, which we're not paying any rent now because the county's provided us with the facility that we're in. So if we move, we have that rent cost, and we're asking the county to help us pay that rent cost by funding the $1,500 per month in rent. You might ask, well, what's going to happen at the end of your 2-year guaranteed lease? Well, hopefully, the county will consider potentially purchasing this property because it could have a lot of uses, including ours, going forward into the future. Or SAFT will be able to secure the necessary financing from other sources to be able to purchase the property ideally for itself.
If we were going to consider purchasing it, would it be better to enter into a lease purchase now with them instead of throwing away that money for 2 years and then purchase?
Actually, I addressed that with the owner, and he said that the $1,500 a month covers his insurance, and there's no upside to that $1,500. So he said there would be no point in doing a lease purchase. There's no money that could go towards the purchase.
Are they not requiring a triple net lease thing? They're covering all the maintenance. Is that what you're saying? That's why you just this.
I mean, Commissioner Levent, arrived at 219.
I have agreed to the point. Have they discussed with themselves? Sometimes people in this market believe in 2 years from now that the value of any property is much greater than, and they're trying to get to that day. Will they give you a first option right guaranteed price today for what that price would be in 2 years?
He did not state that. He said the price today is $695 and includes brokerage fees, and he is anticipating it being more valuable with the court improvements in downtown in a couple of years. So he did give us 2 years, a third year option at the same rent price, and then from there we would have to negotiate if he didn't sell it.
The rent is very good.
Yes, it's very good.
It's very generous.
Not as good as zero.
Right.
But I'm just curious if you took a moment to ask him what he would do for a first right purchase with your same rent and all. So at least you have a price set for 2 years that won't be a gamble or a risk to what it might be at that time. You have some idea of what it might be if you choose to take that first option to purchase.
He's going to build in some incentives if he's going to put it 3 years out. But I mean, do we want to buy this type of building 3 years from now?
I don't know, but it's nice to have the option. You can always walk away with that penalty, or you can take it if you want to.
Yeah.
You can build your own. But at least you have that option. And if it's better dollar for dollar to build your own, you can make a better decision.
How old is the building? In the heating and air?
1990s.
It's
George Bridge.
Why not?
Yeah.
How old is it?
It has a brand new roof.
I can't believe that we see the property they're on as so unbelievably valuable that we can, help them just develop something there. Costing us nothing.
What, the property on that? But what we got, we have to incorporate that property, maybe worth some more than having a cast one that we can have some plans for.
Everybody keeps talking about we could.
Judge, you talked about maybe a different entrance. Did I hear that correctly?
Yes.
How much in renovations do you think the building would get?
Dollar-wise.
It's a big current, so.
You said up to $12,000, which was going to be covered by?
At the future site that we want to go to, but not at the current, not the current location. Current location, were you asking about current or the future?
I was.
The current. The renovations that we did when we first took over the property was valued at around $70,000 that we put into it. A lot of it was donated. I don't have an exact estimate, but the discussions that we've had would be around the same, because we'd have to put in another entrance, another parking lot. We'd have to build out additional rooms. I don't see it being possible to.
It's too small without spending a lot of money on to expand.
Absolutely, we'd have to add several more rooms.
I'm just trying.
Additional entrances.
Yeah, I understand this is y'all's best option. Y'all looked around and have to rely on y'all's opinion. Y'all know your business.
The county staff has also assisted us in that process.
Exactly. I know a little, and Ms. Mills was a little bit in real estate market, so the numbers get landed, you kind of understand about where the value is or not. How many acres on that land that would be included?
1.5 to 2 acres.
Actually, 1.3. Maybe it is.
On the new facility?
Yes. The new facility.
Judge Jackson and I talked about this in relation to the governor, is changing the juvenile justice bill is in right now, and the county is going to be, it's going to be placed in our lap to take care of juvenile justice within our counties. Sending out a lot fewer and developing our own programs, and he believes that this will tie in the preventative portion of meeting the needs of what's fixing to be dropped in our lap too. So it does serve a twofold.
Is this building certainly?
No.
Well, programs that
program,
will
see us. The size of the building could also provide us additional opportunities to meet these other mandates that are coming down the pipe. House Bill 242, I believe it is, was passed by the House, the Juvenile Justice Reform Act, which includes these new mandates on the juvenile justice reform side. So everyone fully expects this bill will be passed by the legislature this year. Let's go for the Senate.
We give you additional funds last year, actually. Ken?
Through the social services grant. Yes.
How much was that?
Last year or this year?
This year.
This year, 15. The first year was 10, the second year was 11, and this year was 15.
Which is 10. I mean, are they wanting that on top of the grant?
Oh, yeah.
That's what I mean. So it's 15 plus 10.
Yeah, that funding helps to improve some operational things within the program, like higher security equipment, some operational costs, things like that. So this would be separate.
Because of the size of the building, our utilities will be quite a bit more than they are now in the present building. We're estimating $1,000 per month. So we'll have higher upkeep costs in this facility as well. So we'll still be seeking all of our other sources of funding to plus upping those to probably help us maintain this larger space as well.
Two things that might help you with this, just a little historical data. You probably recall this, and it's in your books. April 24, 2012, the board directed me and other staff to get with Judge Jackson and his staff to look at and discuss options for a long-term solution. I don't want you to think that he just showed up here today just asking for money. This was actually a directive from the board. And since that time, we've been working on this, and that's why he's here today. As far as funding, if you go to your agenda request, you've probably already seen this, but what we're talking about, in addition to any money that's funded through social services in that grant, you're looking at approximately seven months worth of rent, if you were a lease for 2013, you'd be looking at $10,500 for 2013, $18,000 for 2014, and then $7,500 for 2015. And that would be less any grant reimbursement. So if you wanted to kind of break it down with regard to the amount of funding that they're requesting today for 13 and for 14 and the remainder for 15, those are the numbers you'd be looking at. Just want to draw your attention to those. 2015 would take you through the 3 years. Thank you.
So,
then
at the end of, so the implementation, we've been in a year planning phase for the federal grant, and then the implementation phase is 2 years, and then we can apply for continuation funding, which would allow us an additional 3 years if granted. So the program could go short term or 5 years. And we also talked about at our current facility, we could put another nonprofit in that space that is currently paying rent that would reduce their rent, and we could use that money to offset this funding to where we would be going.
So that would be an option. Another nonprofit in the building
for the remainder of
the current building,
like a Mentor Me or another nonprofit organization.
Can we allow them to rent that building, Ken?
Well, just keep in mind with respect to all of this discussion that we're going to have to link it back, as we have done. Remember with the Social Services Committee, how we've linked it back by way of documentation to things that the county can legitimately fund. And so I'm kind of trying to get a synthesis of where the policy is going, then I'll work with Judge Jackson and staff to make sure that it fits. So the answer is, can they sublease it out? I'd want to see where the direction I get from the board goes a little bit more fried.
Obviously, they have more control over that if they own the building.
Right, and if it's with an entity that we're otherwise funding, there's a Social Services Committee, then I've already done that analysis, and I've already concluded that we can legitimately fund those. So.
Bethany is one of those.
I have a couple of points. I just divided the $9,000 by the dollar figure at 77.2 dollars per square foot. And 1.3 acres is pretty much not an excessive amount of land for that kind of a building. So I'm not going to add any more for the land. This is just my experience, and that's not in stone as an appraisal. Last Thursday, I spent the afternoon with a gentleman by the name of John Adams. I think you know that morning, pastor at Ryan Community Church. And I understand that he was trying to pull together other churches to help you as well, trying to pull together to help the community. Do you see that being an asset to help offset some of this, or is that for different purposes?
It could help the purposes for the visitation center, because what John Adams is trying to assist us with is remedying the extreme lack of placement resources, foster parents that we have available in Forsyth County right now. It's more difficult to make use of the SAFF center without children being placed locally, and to really accomplish all those things that I was talking about previously towards reunification. If you've got kids, you know, in Augusta, we've got some of our kids in Augusta now, you know, baking all over the state. So it all, as I was telling Commissioner Mills when I said earlier, it all links together in one way or the other. So yes, this, you know, that's part of SAFF's mission, is to recruit and support foster parents as well. So yeah. Certainly this facility would be a base for those kinds of efforts.
We would be able to store our resource closet there like we do at our current facility. So when children enter foster care and they come with a trash bag, we provide them with the immediate necessities, luggage, clothing, car seats, furniture, cribs. We also would be able to conduct our monthly support group meetings at the space, we'd be able to do our monthly parent night out for the children in foster and adoptive care. All the programs that we do in addition to the visitation center program.
Y'all might want to use this as a good time to calling all churches to step up and help at this moment. It seems like several of them are coming forward now, and it was a great opportunity.
Well, and with
this, in terms of remodeling and so forth, new facility in particular, that's where we'll be looking for help to.
Sure. Oh yeah, and with this whole new program, I mean, it's all falling in our laps to create our own.
Under House Bill 242, do y'all know of any other facility county that may become available in a couple of years if they lease this, they will something already have, or should we consider, if they're asking $695, do we consider making offers more into line with what our appraisal say is worth in today's world?
That building's too old. I would think we'd be better off to look at some land. We got land at the tax center over on 306. All we got land at the bank. But I think rent is a great deal at $1,500 a month.
It is, I agree.
And I don't see any reason you can't enter into that rent. I would be for it. But I would also like to not look at building future buildings somewhere with funds from the state or grant money or fund money. We have that state program that. One thing we never use it, Doug, the Public Facilities Authority that can build buildings through bonds. We have that we can look at. But we have land. I don't want to spend that kind of money for a 10 or 15 year old building and watch completely remodeled. Only 1 acre of land.
That's
air conditioning, HVAC, it's got a question of the $10,000 possible cost.
That was just an estimation between myself and Mr. Thornton, and that's specific to the warehouse that we could utilize for a joint partnership with Superior Court, maybe drug testing lab, or we could use it as a larger activity space for kids to
but
visit.
But you're gonna take care of her.
Yeah,
you won't be coming back to us asking.
No. And I put the modifications and the utility costs just so the county can see that the organization does have stake in the program, and we
we've got skin in this game.
Absolutely. And that property, because of its location to the fairgrounds, we can utilize the parking lot as a fundraiser for all of the fairground events. The owner's letting us do a fundraiser on the 30th of March for Taste of Forsyth, and with us having the building, so we would be raising money and trying to build up a net so that we can put towards our operations, you know, anything that we need for the program, and also for future assistance with securing a permanent location.
Camp Council, if we have a consensus of the board kind of about taking a vote on, could we authorize you to work with them to see if they can rent the house out to bring in additional funds?
Absolutely. We can do that. We can look at that issue. Have you thought, does the board want to give any direction regarding the notion of just the lease, and would we want to be the actual tenant and then sublease to SAFT, which would be my preference. But anyway, just
whichever you feel saves us money and protects us.
Well, I'd like
liability on us. If we just gave them and they let them lease themselves, that would be liability on them.
I feel like we're probably liable anyway if we're paying the rent. And I think it would give us more control, a little bit more control, at least over making sure that the rent provisions are honored and things of that nature. Not suggesting anything wouldn't be, but it just would make me feel more comfortable.
Gotcha. Y'all feel comfortable with this? Do y'all mind Ken going forward?
Do we
need Ken or?
No, you'll have a motion when you approve all this. So right now, all you're giving me is direction.
Can we add one more thing? If we're going to do the 2 year lease, should we also give direction that we don't start now to try to contribute away the building, at least like look into that? Does that have a done by the time the 2 year lease is up? That will be the time to give the direction. We start looking at what the options might be.
We've got the 2 year lease and an option.
An option for 30 at
the same
cost.
What
I'm saying, we're slow.
Let's do this first and we come back to the
building. But don't forget about it because we'll never have it done in time to get here.
And our time frame to implement this program is the beginning of June. We're planning to submit. We've been working on all of our policies and procedures and our site plans, and we're also looking to open up a satellite office in Dawsonville at the same time. So we're working with that county and our agent in that side as well. But we are looking to submit everything as a package at the beginning of April, maybe the mid-April.
That would include the site here, so that the Office of Violence Against Women's got to review our proposed site and tell us and make sure that it is. Meets all the criteria.
Can you get with our attorney, county attorney, and work all this out and bring it back to us?
We will do that. Judge Jackson and I have been able to work through a lot of this before, so I'm not the least bit concerned about it.
I heard you mention something about mentors, whatever that was.
The program that we had thought of as being a good potential tenant for the current location on Veterans Memorial Boulevard, if we went that route, once we moved out, was Mentor Me North Georgia. And I indicated, Mr. Gerard said that if they were already receiving funds on the Social Services Committee, he's already done the analysis, indicate that that is an organization county can fund. And I said Mentor Me is an organization that's already been funded through the Social Services Committee. So in effect, Ken's already done that analysis and determined that they are an appropriate organization for the county to help support the funding.
The two things, one is, were they interested in this building?
Two,
if it goes that way, everybody should know that it's highly probable that that adds revenue, which can be then brought over to this new building, because they would want similar to what you've got now, I would expect.
Well, the idea would be is they're paying rent, $1,000, $1,200, $1,500 a month now. So if we offered them this building at $500 a month, then they're getting a big break on rent from what they're paying now, but the county's also getting a little bit of an income stream to offset the $1,500 a month that rent cost was our thinking on the iron bills.
Probably that's to subsidize it. There's possibilities out there.
But also, let's say they don't take it, we're allowed, it's our building at that point, we don't leave, and we can rent to anybody we want to for any amount of money we wanted to, correct?
Right, yeah, we could rent it just in the world of commerce. You know, right. The only trick here has been is that I think SAFT is getting it for, I think, $10 a year or something, so it's
correct. So we could offset income, should we do it to the private?
That's right. Yes. They can't work with it, so I got you. Any other questions about this?
We'll get with the judge.
Okay. Sure. Thank you.
Sounds good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
We appreciate your time.
Item two, the establishment of 2013 local supplement for South County Solicitor as appointed by Governor Deal. Director of the Board.
Yes, Commissioners. On March 6th, Governor Deal appointed Attorney Donna Gopal to fill the Solicitor General vacancy in Forsyth County. The Solicitor General position